and the 1990 World Championship belongs to the Cincinnati Reds. As you might expect, they pile out of the dugout.
And when the Reds got back last night, there was a huge crowd waiting for them to welcome them at the airport.
Turn, these fans came to Cincinnati's airport. Hundreds showed up trying to get as close as they could to see their conquering heroes.
This is where the fans got to see the players on the other side of the fence. A lot of them brought signs. A lot of them brought brooms. All of them brought their voices.
That, of course, is exactly what the Reds did, beating the Oakland A's in four straight. The fans loved it, and as they got off the plane, the players loved that the fans were here.
I guess we won the World Series.
This is a team which almost no one thought would win their division, let alone win it all. The scars from the Pete Rose scandal were still too recent, too fresh. Even series MVP Jose Rijo admitted he had his doubts.
In your wildest dreams after what happened here last year, did you really think you were going to be standing here at 10 o'clock on a mid-October night celebrating a World Championship?
Never. You know, I never thought. I always believe in my team. I know we got a great team. But last year, you know, we never think we're going to be here this soon.
It's something Marge had wanted ever since she bought the team 5 years ago. Finally, she and Shotzi could celebrate with, as she put it, her fans. She'll get another chance to celebrate a couple of minutes from now down on the square. Steve Forrest, News 5.
As you might imagine, Fountain Square was packed like it is now when we won the World Champion Saturday night. It was an unofficial party, but it was a party.
And the party didn't just stay here on the square. People filled downtown streets, honking their horns, whooping it up, screaming and yelling that we were indeed the world champions. News 5's Monica Abler takes us back to Saturday night's incredible excitement.
A lot of people said they could not do it, but the Reds did do it. They took on the Oakland A's, and not only did the underdog come out on top, it swept the A's off their feet. Now the Reds proudly accept the title of 1990 World Series champions, and all of Cincinnati is celebrating with them. Immediately following the victory announcement Saturday night, fans thronged onto Fountain Square. Soon a sea of people cheered for the Reds so loudly it was deafening, but it was easy to tell what it was they were saying.
Davis cranked this two-run homer in the first inning, and the Reds were on their way.
They spanked Stewart and the A's 7-0 to take game one.
We came out and we did today what we've been doing all year, playing good aggressive baseball, and that's why we won.
This is one game. Like I said before, you don't win nothing for one game. I mean, we beat them pretty good today, but tomorrow's another day.
Game two saw Billy Hatcher continue his hot hitting. Over the first two games, Hatcher set a series record with 7 consecutive hits. This triple led to the run that tied game two at 4 apiece. But this game came down to the 10th inning. Joe Oliver's hit down the third baseline scored Billy Bates. The Reds win 5-4 and take a 2-0 lead in the series.
We got a lot of confidence going out to Oakland. Where we're at, nobody would believe it. No way you'd say that we'd be up 2-0. We were the only ones that believed that. We believe it in ourselves. And we showed a lot of people and started to make believers out of people that were for real there. We got a good club.
We got 2 more games to win. I don't really, care about records. I just want to win some games. And if we can, win 2 more, I'd give that to her. They could have the record. I just want to ring.
Game 3 saw the series shift to Oakland, and Chris Sabo soon stunned the A's faithful with 2 home runs. The Reds scored 7 times in the third inning alone. And in the field, Sabo was a star there, too. The Reds go on to take Game 3 easily, 8-3 the final.
Sabes makes the plays. He just makes the plays. He comes to play and is in the game in every pitch. And, one thing about Sabes is, and the same with Larkin, they both anticipate the ball being hit to them and are ready to make the plays when it happens.
That's a wonderful feeling, I get the chance to open the worst serve. Now I get the chance to close it. I don't think anybody can ask for anything more.
Game 4 got off to a shaky start for the Reds. Billy Hatcher had to leave the game shortly after he was hit by a pitch. Then the Reds lost another starting outfielder. Eric Davis suffered a bruised kidney diving for this Willie McGee double. But the Reds hung tough. Jose Rio set down the final 20 batters he faced. Then, after the Reds scratched for a couple of runs in the eighth, Randy Myers ended it by getting Carney Lansford to pop out to Todd Benzinger. With that, the Reds completed the 4-game sweep with a 2-1 victory and brought home the club's 5th world championship.
There was nobody in this clubhouse that thought they could beat us. We really didn't. And we went out and we played like we didn't think they could beat us. And we've accomplished something we worked long and hard for.
I'm so happy. You can enjoy this now. This may never happen again. But I don't care if it ever happens again. I'd say I've been here once. I'm the world champion, part of the best team in the world. Best team in the world. Anybody can say anything they want. You beat them fair and square.
All in all, it was an incredible display of baseball by a great team. And it's laughable that the A's could say we're a better team. It's laughable. They played them 4 up. They got beat fair and square, just like George said.
They beat them in every element of the game. They won the close ones, and they won the runaways.
Yes, they did.
Awesome. Real good.
$39.95.
Check your newspaper for details on a location near you.
Marketing this morning about a half an hour ago, and the condition, Eric's condition hasn't really changed. Severely bruised kidney. He's going to be here at the hospital for 5 to 7 days, roughly. The doctors were on their way as we went on today to check him this morning. We hope that maybe as the day goes on, that we get a chance to either talk to the doctor directly, or possibly, if Eric's up to it, get a chance to speak to him. But I don't know how possible that is at this particular time. So, you know, he's still in ICU, and he's still being monitored very closely.
Okay, all our thoughts are with him, from Cincinnati to Eric Davis. You know, he was an inspiration to a lot of people during the game. It was a very exciting series because of Eric.
And during the course of the week, obviously, we'll continue to pass along to you the condition of Eric Davis, and we hope he gets home as soon as possible. Okay, we are going to be in a little while. They're getting ready with the parade. We're going to be talking to Pat Berry, who's
the
job.
Parade route. You know, the rain is kind of causing some problems for the parade, I believe. But, you know, it's not exactly going to stop.
If we can't go to the parade, we bring the parade to us, or at least Pat Berry we do.
Here's the information I just got from the Cincinnati Police. Because of the rain and the steady rain, they're not going to be able to put the players in convertibles like they originally planned. They're going to put the players in a couple of buses and drive the parade route. I guess the guys will stick their face pressed up against the glass. You'll be able to see them when they come by. And then Marge and Lou are coming down in private cars in a different route. They're all going to come over here and walk up the stage. We'll be able to see them doing that and see the players leaving the bus. But there's not going to be, unfortunately, because of this darn rain coming down right now, there won't be that traditional convertible parade. We don't have ticker tape, so maybe it doesn't make any difference anyhow.
That's okay. Right now, the fans just want to be here. Not so much even to see the guys in the convertibles, but really just to let the players know, hey, thanks a lot for giving us a great year.
And the celebration. It's been 14 years, you know. We deserve to celebrate no matter what the weather is.
Yeah, the last time we were in the World Series, we swept also. The Reds don't know how to lose a World Series game.
That's right. You were just saying they hadn't lost a World Series game since 1975.
When the Red Sox beat them, you're absolutely right. I'm sorry it's raining, but there's nothing we can do about it. It didn't rain during the games.
That was very
I'm so sorry. It's not my fault. I'm sorry it's raining.
Okay, I tell you what. We're going to take a quick break now. We're going to be back with more coverage of the parade and the rally, welcoming the Cincinnati Reds World Champions.
Tab combines Tylenol's painkiller with Sudafed's decongestant to work better than either one alone. It stops the pain. Sinutab stops sinus pain.
It starts with itch and irritation, and then hemorrhoid flare-up. For soothing, cooling relief on contact, get Tux medicated pads. Tux pads, the one hospital trusts most.
Attention accident victims. The insurance industry's own secret studies prove accident victims who have lawyers collect far more cash and benefits than victims who handle their own cases. So hurry. Call Eugene Rothschild, 579-8900. For the last 30 years, we've collected millions of dollars for hundreds of accident victims. And we'll collect all the cash and benefits you have coming. Remember, handling your own claim could cost you a fortune. So hurry. Call Eugene Rothschild, 579-8900.
The problem with many car repair guarantees is they cover very little. But there's one that covers more repairs longer than any other. The Lifetime Service Guarantee from Ford and Lincoln Mercury dealers. It's peace of mind for people who expect a little more.
Stop by one of the Cincinnati area Ford and Lincoln Mercury dealers, see the 1991 models, and pick up a copy of the Lifetime Service Guarantee.
Want to buy carpet like a pro? Buy it from the pro. Tim Hogan's Carpet Outlet, where your satisfaction is our responsibility. This week, we're featuring savings up to 50% on Montana Wear Data Carpet, manufactured by Queen Carpet Mill. Choose from a wide range of stain-resistant and durable plush, sculptured, and trackless carpets, all up to half off. Plus, make no payments till May 1991. See our selection of Montana Wear Data Carpets, where you'll find name brands and quality without the expensive price at all Tim Hogan's Carpet Outlet.
Well, it is an exciting day out here on Fountain Square. Even if it is raining, we're still going to have a good time with the celebration for the 1990 World Champion Reds.
And every World Series, it seems, has its little sidebars to it, its little stories that aren't on the baseball field but off, but are just as heart-rending. And I guess one had to do with Tom Browning.
You know, Tom Browning was at the ballpark, and they told him to, you know, go ahead, your wife's having a baby, go ahead and leave. And then all of a sudden it's, wait a minute, come back, come back. Here's the story of Tom Browning and Little Tucker.
Well, we move to the bottom half of the first inning, and Tom Browning goes to the mound.
When Tom Browning took to the mound in Game 3 of the World Series in Oakland, it was a night of firsts. It was Tom's first World Series appearance. It was also Little Tucker Browning's first World Series.
At least he doesn't have to worry about him being born today. He was so worried that the baby would be born on the day he had to pitch.
Tucker threw his parents a curve. You see, during Game 2 of the series at Riverfront Stadium, Tom had to leave the game to drive his wife, Debbie, to the hospital. 30 minutes after the game, Tucker was born. You better believe this little rookie grabbed a few headlines of his own. And even before the big game Friday night, Mom and Dad were talking more than just baseball.
We talked we talked about the baby. He wanted to make sure the baby was okay. And he said that he had seen a lot of reporters, but nobody talked to him about the game. It was all about the baby.
All of the media attention and the fact that his dad pitched in Game 3 of the World Series didn't seem to faze little Tucker. He'll have to catch most of this on the highlight reel. You see, he decided to sleep through most of this game. Debbie and Tom call little Tucker the Reds' good luck charm. It's a story Mom and Dad can't wait to share with him.
He'll be excited. I mean, it's not going to mean anything to him for a long time, but it will one day.
Curtis Fuller, News 5.
You bet it will one day. One day it'll mean an awful lot, and right now it means an awful lot to all the fans here and obviously also to Tom Browning and his whole family. You know, baseball is a game of superstition. Players believe that if they just follow a particular routine, maybe wearing the same socks, or Ron Oster during the season shaved his head, if they do something, it works. Well, for Jose Rio, he believes that the key to his arm is his stomach.
Yeah.
Every time before he pitches, he goes and gets a certain kind of a meal.
Well, you know, Jose was the most valuable player. I guess you had the most valuable meal. This is Bruce Campanella, and that's where he heads every time before he plays in the ballpark, right?
Right, right.
So what does he eat that does it? What is it? What is in the lasagna that is just perfect that makes it work?
Good luck. As well as skill, I guess.
Does he talk a lot when he's there before the game?
Yeah, he's a nice, down-to-earth guy. You couldn't meet a nicer guy.
And it is kind of superstitious.
And his wife, too.
Yeah, yeah. They bring the whole family in there. Right. It's like a big table. It's a big spread. Are you
table
nervous?
Table, too.
Are you nervous when they come in?
Yeah.
Does he leave a big tip?
Yeah, I'd say so.
Yeah.
I would say.
Because we'll get on his case if he doesn't.
He's about to leave a bigger tip, I have a feeling, for the meal. Now, did you have to fly something out to Oakland for him, or did you pack it up?
That was just my brother, Anthony, came up with the idea of sending some out there. So we just kind of jumped on it, and Federal Express got in on it, and everybody was just real cooperative. Even out there at that Park 55 hotel,
yeah.
The chef out there agreed to do it and everything, so great.
Well, the recipe seems to work, so thanks to you filling his stomach, his arm was able to give us a world championship.
Okay.
Bruce, thanks a lot.
Thanks
a lot, Bruce, and not bad for a cook. Well, you ought to, maybe before the newscast, we could get like
would it work?
Maybe a commentary.
We'll close
would be
on Monday.
Okay, thanks a lot, Bruce. You know, meals do mean a lot to the players. Like, some of them try to eat spaghetti. They try to eat carbohydrates. But maybe
right.
It works. Maybe it had something to do with it. And they certainly proved it in this World Series.
They also need an inspiration. Sometimes the inspiration comes from what they eat, and sometimes it comes from music. Well, this World Series in Cincinnati will be remembered for the theme song which inspired the Reds, You Can't Touch This.
Touch it.
Let's hear it.
Can't touch this.
Can't touch this.
Can't touch this. Can't touch this. Can't touch this. Can't touch this.
Break it down.
touch this. The Oakland A's certainly couldn't touch this. But as we said earlier, you know, part of this celebration is because we had one incredibly inspirational and great player, Eric Davis. And here is Tony Schultz with a get well, Eric, we miss you, number 44. Tony's one of the thousands that are down here on Fountain Square with rain gear, some with umbrellas, all ready to bring home the Cincinnati Reds, world champions of baseball. The year is 1990. It is now. We're champs.
We're excited about it, and we'll be right back with more from Fountain Square right after this.
My, you're up early, dear.
I've got time for a tennis match before work.
He's like a new man since we bought our Dreamland waterbed. His chiropractor recommended a waterbed, and frankly, I love it. It's a soft-sided waterbed with a motion-reduced mattress. Waterbeds really have changed, haven't they?
Waterbeds have changed, and Dreamland Waterbeds has Sealy Hydropedic waterbed mattresses. Sealy is a brand name you can trust. Shop Dreamland today for the prettiest beds in town.
Hi, I'm Philly Indriott of Blinds Direct, inviting you to visit one of our five Blinds Direct factory showrooms in this area to see firsthand some great ideas and window treatments for your home or office. And I invite you to come by and see how much money you can save by ordering your mini blinds, vertical blinds, and pleated shades from our very own local factory.
Visit the Blinds Direct factory outlet store near you. Newport, Florence, Cherry Grove, on Coleraine, and in the Home Center Mall. For quality and low price, we beat them all. Blinds Direct.
It's morning in your town. That's the Johnsons. They're adding a bedroom with a home equity loan from the Money Store. There's Pete Golden's dream car. A call to the Money Store put it there. And now America's largest independent home equity lender introduces FHA Title I loans. They're government insured with no equity required. FHA Title I home improvement loans. Just one more reason to call the Money Store. Call us day or night. 1-800-LOAN-YES.
Who do you want as your next governor? Where do the candidates stand on the issues you care about? Monday night at 8, Anthony Celebrezzi and George Voinovich swear off in the League of Women Voters of Ohio 1990 gubernatorial debate. Live for 60 minutes, the candidates answer the question you want to know before you go to the polls on Election Day, November 6th. The League of Women Voters of Ohio 1990 gubernatorial debate. Monday night at 8 on this NBC station.
Only on your exclusive 24-hour news channel.
Obviously, when the Reds go to the World Series, it does great things for our town. Mostly, it does things in terms of spirit. Everybody feels good about this community. It's also a great sales technique for the rest of the country. It puts Cincinnati on the map in a very positive way. But it's more than just inspiration. Going to the World Series also means a lot of dollars for our community. At one point, we estimated $40 million for the city of Cincinnati if it went to a seven-game series. Well, the Reds were too good for that. We wiped out the Oakland A's in only four games, so we probably made in the area of about $30 million. At least those are the estimates. The fellow that knows the most about this, of course, is the mayor of our fine city, Charlie Lucan. And Charlie, you've got to be feeling great.
Hey, I've never seen people in Cincinnati have so much fun for the past several years. They're having a great time, and it's good for everybody. It's good for the city.
How did we do economically?
They think it's between $35 and $40 million, Jerry, but we get so much advertising. I mean, how many times were we on national TV, at the Skyline, how many people are talking about Cincinnati? You couldn't buy that kind of publicity, so we're riding high today.
And this is going to mean a lot in the future, too. We got businesses that start thinking a little bit more about Cincinnati, and maybe we're going to locate there. Hey, they got a great team.
Yeah, and I hope it makes people think a little bit about how important these professional sports teams are to Cincinnati, because, boy, we just couldn't get this kind of attention without them.
Have you noticed that, because you were mayor also when we went to the Super Bowl, have you noticed that, what is the difference between the town in a World Series and the town with a Super Bowl?
Well, we won. I think the sentiments would have been the same had we won. But I mean, we have a new symbol of civic pride down here today, a broom. I mean, who would have ever thought?
A red broom.
And people are having such a good time. There was not this kind of enthusiasm for the Super Bowl, but that's, I think, because we won.
Directly translate into the city budget? I mean, we talk about the overall economy.
No, it really doesn't, Jerry, but I'll tell you, over the long term,
you can't measure it because, as Norma said, you don't know how many businesses are going to take a second look at Cincinnati. You don't know how many people are going to locate here, feel better about Cincinnati as a result of this kind of thing. So it's got a big, big impact on all of us.
And it is an exciting time
sure
for
is.
The city.
Sure
you know, I mean, if you could have done something about the rain, Charlie would have felt just a little bit better about
I
it.
I let
but
you down. I'm sorry.
Yeah, well, that's okay. So did Pat. So don't worry about it.
What's next in terms of making sure that the Bengals win?
Well, we're going to start that tonight. I mean, isn't it nice in Cincinnati? I mean, we're going to have this today, and then we're going to have a Bengals-Browns game this evening.
And you thought being mayor was tough,
yeah,
huh?
I thought
this
easy.
Is a piece of cake. They don't know.
I think being mayor is as much fun as we ever have in the last few years. It's great.
All right. Thanks a lot, Charlie.
Thank you, Charlie.
It's a lot of fun. You know, the sweep has Cincinnati is buying up just about everything they can. There's T-shirts, there's hats, as you can tell. Now there's probably going to be umbrellas and, of course, the red brooms. But over at Cook's Sporting Goods, customers were waiting at the door to buy souvenirs. They were describing businesses as unbelievably heavy. At the Reds gift shop in the Hyatt Regency, stuff is also selling off the shelves with fans buying whatever they can just to remember this season. And at the Velveshin plant in Fairfax, workers are turning out sweatshirts and T-shirts as fast as they can. We're told that before the end of the week, more than 120,000 shirts will have been printed. 120,000 shirts. So where's yours and mine, right? We've got red on at least, though.
We got red on it. We probably got about 10 in the car, in the truck, and at home.
Right,
and
right, right.
And they're selling everything they're making because right now this is the one business in town that everybody shares in. I mean, if Procter & Gamble has a good year, you don't get a rally on Fountain Square.
Nobody starts wearing Ivory Soap T-shirts, but red T-shirts.
Professional sports is the one business that everybody gets to share in the glory of the victory, and this is great for community spirit. You know, before we were talking to the mayor about what it means in dollars and cents, it's immeasurable what it means to making people feel good about the town they live in, and this is a great place to live. Now the national media knows it, though you wouldn't have thought so listening to some of those broadcasts.
Yeah, the broadcasters were, you know, well, they were giving the A's this excuse and the A's that excuse, and maybe I'm a homer, but I thought that there was just a little prejudice to the other side, and what the heck, we showed them, and we showed them in style, four straight games, and the A's are out of there.
Okay, we're going to be taking a break, and we'll be coming back with more of this incredible celebration for the world champion Cincinnati Reds. We'll be right back.
Remember to call Mom and Dad as soon as I get out of surgery.
I will, don't worry.
It's supposed to take 3 hours. Did you bring something to read?
I brought some work from the office. Hey, are you okay?
The issue? Our environment. The candidates, Charlie Lucan, Ken Blackwell. Closing down the hazardous waste incinerator, Lucan voted yes. Blackwell voted no. A new clean water plant, Lucan voted yes. Blackwell voted no. The right to know on hazardous chemicals, Lucan voted yes. Blackwell voted no. The difference is clear and clean. Charlie Lucan for Congress, putting the first district first.
Who can you trust these days to take care of your car when it starts shaking?
Or pulling, or rattling.
Or squeaking.
Or suspension or alignment? Nobody beats Midas.
I worry about something I can't see.
What your eyes can't see, our state-of-the-art diagnostic equipment will show you. Whatever the problem, we keep it from getting bigger. So, for alignment shocks or struts, nobody beats Midas. Nobody.
Buy any Midas shock or strut until October 31st and get the second one for 50% off installed.
The Incredible Eyeglass Factory, where real people save real money every day on top quality eyeglasses and contacts.
I shopped and shopped for my contacts. At the Eyeglass Factory, I got 2 pair for less than what most places charge. And while I was there, I got this pair of glasses. Free.
At the Eyeglass Factory, you get 2 pairs of contact lenses and a pair of eyeglasses, all for $39.95. $39.95 contacts at the Eyeglass Factory. Check your newspaper for details on a location near you.
Well, the rain's here, but so are the fans. They are not being kept away by the rainfall. It is a sea of umbrellas, and more people are coming. It's getting to be the lunch hour now, and they're coming on the second-level skywalks. Everywhere we look, we're seeing
crowds. It's packed. I'm looking out here through the umbrellas, and the streets are packed. They got the streets closed off. This is a celebration.
morning in the trial of two former Cincinnati police officers charged with a cover-up in the Kevin Schroeder case. Fired Officer Mark Taylor and retired Sergeant James Lamping are charged with obstruction of justice. They allegedly covered up the fact that off-duty Officer Schroeder had been drinking the night of a fatal wreck last year. Schroeder was convicted Friday of vehicular homicide, but was acquitted on DUI charges. Schroeder's hospital blood test, which showed him above the legal DUI limit, was not allowed to be used as evidence in his trial. However, Judge Fred Cardellano said it can be allowed in the trial of the two ex-cops.
On Capitol Hill, budget negotiators are at it again this morning, trying to come to an agreement on how to cut the deficit. But as NBC's Henry Chan tells us, there are big disagreements over who should pay and how much.
At Sunday meeting, Sununu was as optimistic as everyone else, thinking he had made a deal with the president's offer to raise the tax rate, but the Democrats wanted more. They want a tax surcharge of 7.5% on millionaires, limits on the tax deductions for the wealthy, and relief for Medicare recipients.
And that the proceeds from that be used to reduce the adverse effect on the elderly beneficiaries under Medicare, particularly the poor elderly, and to reduce the amount of any gas tax that may be required.
Republicans say they've gone far enough.
I just finished talking to the president 30 seconds ago. He will not accept their last offer.
Although Sununu and other White House negotiators never returned to the meetings, congressional leaders did and said they were still hopeful.
I'd say they've broken off. We're all here.
If the Congress does not reach an agreement by midnight on Wednesday, federal government is supposed to shut down.
Another showdown between the president and Congress is heating up over a new civil rights bill. Bush is expected to veto the bill today because he says it encourages companies to set up quotas. Congress said it'll try to override that veto, but it's unclear whether they have enough votes. A major confrontation is heating up in the Persian Gulf right now. The Navy says U.S. and Australian ships have stopped an Iraqi tanker and sailors are getting ready to board it. This is the second time in 3 days this ship has been stopped. It's already defied orders to return to Iraq, and yesterday it ignored warning shots from a U.S. destroyer.
And at 11:39, that's going to do it from Studio B for now.
And we're going to go back to Jerry and Norma for all the fun down at Fountain Square right after this.
Crashes left over 45,000 Americans dead. Hundreds of thousands more seriously injured, their lives changed forever as a result of someone else's carelessness. If you're a victim of an accident, do you know where you can turn for help?
Call Tom Jackson for a free consultation.
They have had years of experience representing innocent victims. Put their experience to work for you.
Tom Jackson, 489-9191.
Series presentation.
It's Sabo at the plate. Oh, and he really takes a bite out of that one. Sabo takes first and hits for second, and he gobbles up second. But it looks like he'll have to hold up there. You never know what the wily Sabo will do in these situations. Looks like he'll try to steal third. Oh, and he's thrown out by Sabo.
Okay, Hot Dog, you're out of here.
All right, I'm going.
Cover all the bases. Slide home with plenty of delicious Oscar Mayer regular bun length and the new light hot dogs. Oscar Mayer quality meats are a hit every time.
Many of you have seen me like this. You've even seen me like this. But very few of you have seen me like this. This is a $450 suit, but I only paid $249. Not because I'm me, but because I shop at Gentry. Hey, if you don't shop at Gentry, you must have money to burn, or you look great in your underwear.
We are back here on Fountain Square, and in the background, you can hear the tape recording of Marty Brenneman bringing you
the highlights of this exciting series that we had with the Cincinnati Reds. It is an exciting time. This is what it's all about. No, he fought.
what they say. Pam Thompson.
Now that banner's upside down. Look at that red banner.
Yeah.
But it doesn't matter. I mean,
we tossed the whole world upside down once in the banister. Fans starting to yell sweep. Everybody's kind of getting into it. More people down here on the square than along the parade route at this time.
That's
obviously
right.
Because of the weather.
Well, the parade isn't really going to go off like it was intended to, I suppose.
It was supposed to be an open
ticker tape motorcade. Kind of parade. Yeah, not ticker tape, but you know, the same kind of parade. Everybody was going to be in convertibles. Well, at this point, they'd have gotten very, very wet. We don't want to get our players wet that won the 1990 World Champion, so they're going to arrive in a bus. Marge and Lou. Up, and I'm sure Shotzi will be along, probably in a raincoat, and they're going to come up from another angle. So we're going to have that for you. We're going to get it just as soon as we can. But right now, let's head out to Pat Barry.
Pat, tell me, what is the situation where you are?
Well, the situation right now is George Vogel and I are standing here right on Vine Street. Believe it or not, we're right on the other side of you, but you can't see us from the all the crowd. What a crowd, huh,
George? Yeah, nice crowd out here, regardless of the rain. You know, one of the fans stopped me and said, "This isn't rain, this is all the tears from Oakland."
Hey,
to which
man.
I said, "It should be raining harder in that case."
I like it. The police have now stopped the traffic. The buses are now moving on 4th Street. They'll be making a right up Vine Street and stopping right here at Fountain Square. Marge and Lou are coming in separate cars, and they'll stop here too. And what we're going to try and attempt to do is talk to some of the guys as they get out of the bus. That's the situation down here. The street is absolutely closed off. It's got lots of people. Take a look. We got these guys behind us. Well, I think should be in school right now, don't you think?
They look about school age to me, but we'll let them off for this.
George, 14 years ago, you were still in school. Did you take the day off?
I took several days off. What are you talking about? About a week.
I'm out here with Lonesome George. He's not lonesome today. We'll give you all the parade action, and we'll talk to the players, hopefully, as they disembark the bus in just a little bit. Jerry, Norma, back to you.
Oh. Well, they're back to us now. I'm just cleaning my glasses is what I'm doing.
No,
out from tears, up from the rain.
Such a meaningful
I feel
time
so
for
sorry
you.
For Oakland.
Yeah, so sorry for Oakland. Here's the Reds fan. Why don't you pop up here? Come on. Did you get to see any of the games?
Yes.
Which one did you see?
All the World Series games.
You saw them all. What was your favorite part?
The part of the end where they caught the foul ball. Benzinger caught the foul ball.
That was the last play of the last game, right?
Yes.
And that was the winning play.
Yes.
Who's your favorite player?
Jose Rio.
Well, he was the most valuable player. So, what's your name?
Stephen Bledsoe.
Well, Stephen, thanks. Nice for stopping by. You look like you're decked out pretty well in all your red stuff. And now the things are starting on Fountain Square.
Yeah, what you're hearing behind us on Fountain Square is our radio talk show host, Bill Cunningham, not a shy fellow of any sort.
And he doesn't need a microphone, so
right.
He just yells real loud and you can hear it.
He's getting the crowd rolling, saying that the weather is nice in Oakland, but he'd rather be here in Cincinnati with the rain. And, of course, who wouldn't be with this world championship?
And we're going to be right back with more from Fountain Square right after this.
Why do I have two kids here with me during this Jake Sweeney commercial?
They'll point out these Jake Sweeney dealerships in Tri-County.
And these Jake Sweeney dealerships in Florence.
Florence and Tri-County. See, I could do that.
You did it backwards.
Okay, Florence, Tri-County. How's that?
Better,
okay.
Intelligent choices for real driving satisfaction. See Plymouth Acclaim, Plymouth Sundance, and Chrysler LeBaron 4-Door at Jake Sweeney Chrysler Plymouth Tri-County, the Tri-State's most trusted automotive name.
At Jake Sweeney Chrysler Plymouth, we're thinking of you.
Great party, Chris.
Hey, thanks, Anthony. Here, try one of my tacos.
Let me show you how to make a taco. Start with Old World Bakery's no sugar, no fat, no cholesterol pita bread. Slice it and stuff it with JTM taco filling. Add the toppings for a no-mess, great-tasting taco.
And there's even a 25-cent coupon for JTM taco meat. A quick, great-tasting pita taco, and you get a quarterback.
Nobody gets my quarterback.
Old World Bakery's pita bread and JTM make the perfect party partners.
Dreamland Waterbeds is having a sale on the prettiest beds in town. You'll save $500 on the finest in oak contemporary bedrooms by Arbeck. Save 20% on traditional 18th century bedroom sets. Bookcase waterbeds are sale priced at $229, $199, even $158. Dreamland has Soma mattresses and a full line of Sealy hydropedic soft-sided waterbeds in your choice of firmness. Dreamland Waterbeds has a great selection of kids' beds, too. We've got them all at Dreamland, the prettiest beds in town.
The issue, our environment. The candidates, Charlie Lucan, Ken Blackwell. closing down the hazardous waste incinerator? Lucan voted yes. Blackwell voted no. A new clean water plant? Lucan voted yes. Blackwell voted no. The right to know on hazardous chemicals? Lucan voted yes. Blackwell voted no. The difference is clear and clean. Charlie Lucan for Congress, putting the first district first.
Well, the crowd here was going crazy as Bill Cunningham was exhorting them with some kind of poetry which said how great the Reds were.
Is that what you call a poetry?
Well, whatever. No, as happy as the Reds are, no one is as happy as Marchand.
And they're going to go out to Pat Berry, who has Marchand with him. Pat?
Yes, Marge, how do you feel?
I don't know. It hasn't sunk in. This is what it's all about. The fans here. This is what it's all about.
Isn't this the greatest?
This is the greatest. This is who it's for. It's the fans.
Has it sunk in yet?
Not really.
No?
No, not really.
What's the first thing you're going to do after you get the ring, Marge?
Wear it. Thanks, sweetie.
All right, Marge. Thank you very much. Marge Schatz with Schatzi. He's going to be getting up to the podium here. The crowd is going crazy. We expect Lou Piniella coming up and then the buses with the players on them. We'll let you know, Jerry, as soon as we see them. Back to you.
I tell you what, obviously Marge Schott, the First Lady of Cincinnati, this is something she has dreamt for years, certainly ever since she took over the Cincinnati Reds.
She said she was tired of being a bridesmaid, it was time to win, and they did. Lou Piniella and the team and everybody did.
We'll be talking with more of the stars a little later on. I tell you what, the crowd now is with one finger pointed in the air saying we're number one, waving with the music. I'll tell you, I don't see how they're going to be able to see anything with all the umbrellas here, but it doesn't much matter.
They're probably not going to be able to see anything, but it's the whole excitement, it's the feel of what's going on. We're now hearing in the background, we are the champions of the world. It's a wonderful song and very appropriate for what's going on right now.
Now, one fellow who has been a part of baseball folklore for well over one or two generations is Joe Garagiola. He was not the greatest of ball players, but he became real prominent, and now, of course, you can see him every morning on the Today Show. Joe Garagiola has some views, as he's been in town with the Cincinnati Reds, some views on how great this destiny is.
I wouldn't know where to put my finger to improve this ball club, because they got help from everybody in this series. I don't think that Quinn and Piniella will stand still and just go along and say, hey, we won, so we're going to continue to win. Whatever moves they make, I'm sure it will be well thought out. But I guess I'm not bright enough to think. I wouldn't know where to make a change. You have a year like you have from Sable and Larkin and Davis, and then the bullpen is almost perfection. You can always help yourself. The A's did it with McGee, and they did it with Baines. So I don't know. Maybe Cincinnati can come up with somebody like that. But I think if they open the season with the same personnel, they'd have a real good chance of repeating.
Now that the Reds have won this year, of course, everybody likes to try to compare them to the big red machine of the 70s. I know you saw that team play. And though they don't have perhaps the marquee, the Hall of Famers, the Benches, the Roses, the Morgans, etc., in defense of this team, the 75 Reds, who won 108 games, didn't sweep a team that was not supposed to be a dynasty in the Boston Red Sox. How do you account for that?
Well, that was the great World Series 75. I had the privilege of broadcasting that one. That was the Fisk home run, and that was a whole bunch of things. And that, to me, is still one of the top World Series of all time. But this ball club, they don't have true the marquee. But a championship ball club is built on balance, and this ball club has balance. Do they have defense? You'd have to say yes. Do they have pitching? Certainly they do. Starting pitching, going down to the bullpen, A+. Do they have speed? Yes. Do they have power? Yes. It's a well-balanced ball club. You don't have that one guy who sticks out, but you have balance. And as far as comparing it, the comparison to the 75 team and this team, I'd have to say it'd be like if this was an electric chair and you said to me, Joe, do you want AC or DC? I mean, I'm going to get it in the end, so what's the difference?
That's an exciting interview. You know, Joe Garagiola, you were talking to him at the ballpark, the first game of the World Series. He said he thought Cincinnati was going to win.
You're not
you look like you're crying, but actually he's not. It's the rain.
I enjoyed that. I'm here with this one. Thanks. Oh, I'm getting so excited. Anyway, yes, Marge said before that this is all for the fans. Well, Pat Berry is with those fans for whom it's for.
I'm here with George Vogel. Thank you very much, Jerry. I'm here with George Vogel, and we're just waiting. Have you seen a bus yet, George?
No buses or anything yet. I think we're expecting Lou Piniella next. I think he's going to pull up in one of the fine automobiles they're dropping the people off in, and then the players should be right behind him.
Yeah, you're right. And Marge seemed she was in a daze. I'm sure she hasn't gotten a lot of sleep, and she's been doing a lot of things. Wonder when it's going to finally sink in. Maybe a week or so before she really sinks in.
It may take that long. It's going to be interesting to see what she says to these fans. She's been preaching the fans this and the fans that ever since she took over this club. Today, she gets a chance to go directly to them and talk, and it's going to be fun to hear what she has to say.
I listened to radio. I was listening to him talk on WLW this morning. And, is that a bus? Oh, he's got WLW ready. Already they're talking about next year. So that should be interesting.
It's going to be a tough act.
Once you see if that's Lou, I'm going to talk to some fans. Greg, okay. Follow me over here. We're going to talk. Who are you? I'm trying to find. What's your name?
Stephanie.
Do you have a job?
Yes.
How'd you get out of work?
I work tonight.
Oh, you work tonight. Where's that?
Good Sam Hospital.
Oh, well, good. Say hello to people at Good Sam. And you are?
Jane House.
Where do you work?
I go to UC.
And don't you have classes today?
Not right now, I don't. I kind of skip them. This is more important.
Classes, great. Who are you?
I'm Tiffany.
And where do you live?
Good Sam.
You work at Good Sam?
Yeah, I work.
Were you supposed to work today?
Nope.
We're not getting you in trouble then, huh?
Nah.
All right. That's why people are down there, and they're having a great time. They're pumped up. We've got the corridor open. And just take a look at that. You can see the fans all the way up. That they're packed up there. George, this is exciting, isn't it?
It is. No Lou Piniella yet. The cheers were for one of the policemen on a horse. I guess it was a very pretty horse.
Okay. They're cheering the cops on horses. Jerry, Norma, back to you. We'll let you know when Lou and the players get here.
All right, we're back on Fountain Square, and we've got Marshall on the podium with the trophy.
Just seconds before, she was holding the trophy above her head. Maybe you can see it there. There it is, the World Championship Trophy. Boy, how hard and long they worked for that. The crowd went into a spontaneous roar when Marge walked up there carrying it over her head. I tell you what, next to leading Shotzi, I don't think there's anything else Marge would rather hold than a World Championship trophy. How about that, huh?
Oh, my God.
And I'll tell you what, that's a lot more expensive than Shotzi.
Yeah.
You can imagine kind of salary she's been putting out for a great, great team. And maybe we ought to be saying something about that. The truth is, Marge Schott has put out the money for whatever player that was necessary to bring to the Reds. She never said, I'm not going to spend money.
Absolutely the case.
Did.
Dating back to 1984, and 85 when she took over the team. I mean, she has every time someone, whether it be Pete Rose, Lou Piniella, Bob Quinn, Murray Cook, Bill Burgess, on down the line, if her baseball people told her she needed that player, she put it out.
She
put it out. You can't criticize her for that.
She really wanted a winner, and she was willing to go out and do whatever it took.
And she said it in every opportunity. Every opportunity, and she did that. And the interesting thing about it is this year the additions were made bang, bang, and we saw what they did. Mariano Duncan came in last year in the winter for the Leary trade, and then Billy Hatcher, and that was a trade that everybody criticized because they said this team needs thump.
Yeah.
They didn't need thump. They got that from Sabo, but they did need a spark like Billy Hatcher gave them.
How about hats off and congratulations to Bob Quinn for the job as general manager? You don't hear much about him, but boy, did he put together the trade.
You all know I've said it over and again. I mean, this guy is Major League Baseball Executive of the Year. How can you argue with that?
Well, you know what the other thing is? Bob Quinn wore that same jacket every game, so I think he can get it clean now. What do you think?
Oh, I would say that he can get it clean. But you know, the story of that is remarkable. I mean, the grandfather, father, and he had one item from each. I forget exactly what they were. You know, one other thing about it is, and again, I harped on this all season long, did this team have the character, the heart to win? And when it came right down to it, they showed us all, myself, that they did, in fact, have that. And there was an awful lot of vindication in this World Series sweep.
They were saying some things over there, you know, and they could back it up because they were the world champions, but no longer. All the talk stops here. You know, nobody can say any longer that they're better than the Cincinnati Reds because we proved it on the field where it counts.
We came in here and we showed a lot of people what we're made of. The character of the squad is unbelievable. We keep battling and we really deserve this.
You know, we know we're much better, but they played better than we did, and, you know, you just give credit where credit's due, but I'm proud to be a part of this club, and I'm not ashamed of anything like that.
It takes breaks to win this game, and, you know, four straight against supposedly one of the better teams that ever played this game. You got to feel good about that.
We were definitely underdogs. We proved them that, you know, we weren't going to roll over and die for anybody. We weren't going to give anybody any more credit than they deserve. We were going to go out there, put it to them, and play our number ball game, and they could match it in time, but they didn't seem like anybody could match it.
Some thoughts came through the mind.
Getting a little chill now, huh?
We're getting a parade coming up.
We're coming back on this?
Parade video. Their bikes. Back once.
took him his World Championship hat. And when they gave it to him, Larry leaned over to hug Eric. And Eric clutched him and held him and was in tears. It was his last connection with the team. He wanted to be there so bad. Larry told his brother, I really think that not being there at that moment hurt him more than the injury.
Well, everyone here realizes, there's not a player on that team that doesn't realize that there wouldn't be this parade, there wouldn't be this celebration if they didn't have the leadership of Eric Davis.
I couldn't agree with you more.
I tell you what, we're going to take a look now at pictures of the parade that is now in progress. We could, from here, from our vantage point, we hear the drums and the band.
Starting to go.
And you are looking at pictures, I trust, of the parade as it is going on.
Not exactly the parade that was originally planned for the homecoming for the world champion, but it is a parade nonetheless.
This is Glen Estee High School that we're watching right now, and this must be a thrill for the kids from that school. They'll always remember their greatest thrill was that they got to march in the World Championship Parade. A lot of fans watching on both sides as the Glen Estee Marching High School Band makes its appearance.
One of the things that fascinates me is the number of children here. I was talking to a couple of parents, and they said, hey, take a day off because this is history.
I'm sorry you said that because I had this discussion with my daughter this morning.
No.
Yeah, and I said, Katie, you got to go to school today. So don't tell her that there were any kids here, okay?
Oh, there's only thousands here, Jerry.
Okay, there are now people marching in the parade carrying brooms, recognizing, of course, the wonderful sweep that has become, in the last 3 days, tradition here in Cincinnati now, the sweep of the Oakland A's.
Nobody thought it would happen. You thought it would happen.
I did, but I was
joking.
I thought the Reds would win in six, is what I honestly thought. But no, I didn't believe they'd get the sweep.
I don't think anybody really believed it was going to be a sweep. I think there are a lot of people saying, yeah, the Reds are going to win it, maybe in five, maybe in six, it may take seven, but...
After the sweep, now get this, Rosie Rio. We're talking about this, and she said, I said, you know, I'm taking an awful lot of grief from people because I said this is going to be a tough series, and I thought maybe the A's would win it. She said, look, I didn't think the A's would win it, but I agreed with you. I never, ever thought that this was going to be a sweep.
Yeah.
None of us did.
None of us did, but I tell you what, we've just been watching, as we've been talking, a picture of Fountain Square. Maybe we can get another quick picture of the square. You can see...
Sea of umbrellas, a sea of people, a lot of red.
And now we're going to take a look at Lou Piniella. And if he isn't manager of the year, you know, what a performance. Yeah, he comes over to a new league. People said, well, he wouldn't know how to work when he doesn't have the designated hitter. His wife is with Lou, and I remember when they won the division, they clinched the division, that walk, Greg, that you were kind of talking about down in the clubhouse. He and his wife were walking down the emotional strain of finally a great year.
And you know what? He never let up, though, through the playoffs, through the series, and the interesting thing about it was that he said day one, and he would say it very quietly, you got the sense nothing would please him but to win. He didn't say what, but in his heart, you got the feeling it meant win it all.
Win it all.
And Bob Quinn, as we can see, is also with Lou Piniella. And as Greg was saying just before, a family tradition, 40 years in Major League Baseball, and here Bob gets it on his first try with the Cincinnati Reds.
And two guys, basically, that couldn't do it with the Yankees, came here, boom, and they do it.
Yeah, we got Tony Perez now, and he's along. He was a big red machine man himself, Tony was. The big dog, as they
say.
Big
dog, man.
Yeah, nobody does a better impression of Tony Perez than Greg Ward.
Yeah, no, I've been working on it for so many years. See the ball, hit the ball, that's all I've been doing.
Yeah, and that's about all you know how to react. Okay, Tony Perez, what a thrill it must be for him. One of the links, of course, to the big red machine of the mid-70s. But I tell you, we talked to him after the game Saturday night, and he was very quick to say that this team has its own identity, its own greatness, and it will be heard from in years in the future.
As it should be.
Yes.
And another one of the very surprising things out in Oakland was that Dave Stewart's comment, and how ridiculous. I view this man as very reasonable. He says, we'll be back next year. I don't know about them. I think you can guarantee it.
Right now we're taking a look at Joe Nuxall, Reds radio announcer, good pitcher. He was the youngest pitcher in the major leagues.
Yes. Yep.
During the war year.
And now he's got to...
The old left-hander rounding third.
Yeah,
I'll tell you what. If we can get a picture now of the... Can we go to the podium? Because the crowd is starting to go wild. Lou Piniella has taken the stage, and they were screaming Lou just seconds ago. So are we now looking at a stick mic, please. I'll tell you what, I'll hold this. This is live television, so stick with us. I got a stick mic now? Okay, thanks a lot. Sorry. Okay, and there goes. The Reds are now mounting the podium. The crowd is going wild. Marge Schott shaking hands with everyone who comes up there. The fans are waving.
We are the champion.
We are the champion. The fans are waving their brooms. What a moment for these Cincinnati Reds. I see Joe Nuxall up there.
There are brooms waving around. Even though they said you're not supposed to have a broom on Fountain Square, there are brooms on Fountain Square. Waving in the air, people on people's shoulders. Crowd is excited.
I can see Rob Dibble and Paul O'Neill. I tell you what, you know how you say you can't tell a player without a scorecard? Well, they're not wearing numbers, so from this distance, it's hard to tell.
I bet I can tell, Jerry.
It's hard to tell who we're looking at. Tony Perez is up there and wearing an old-style Reds hat. They wore that hat back when Tony first came up with the Reds, the white hat with the red stripes. And Paul O'Neill is holding his child up there. I'm not sure his kid can really take in what it's all about, but they'll keep the tape and they'll savor the moment.
I don't know if you can see, there are people even in the trees around the top.
Jeff Reed is up there. What a role he played. Maybe a
better. We're here with Jose Rio. How do you feel, Jose?
That's unbelievable. I've never seen anything like that in my life.
Have you got any rest?
No, I don't need enough.
Good for you. Congratulations.
Thanks,
like
it's
this.
A great honor.
something each and every one of you ought to do on your way home or back to work. Stop at a gift shop, get a card, and send it to that guy out in Oakland in the hospital that gave us his all, Eric Davis. A few years ago, they sold the Reds, and some people even talked about the Reds leaving Cincinnati, if you can imagine that. And somebody stepped forward, kept the Reds in Cincinnati, and now we're welcoming her back, along with her world champion, Cincinnati Reds, Marge Schott. Marge.
It's been 5 long years for all of us, but I want you to know that we won this for the fans. Without you, I don't know what we would do, and I think all of our players who have never been to Cincinnati do not believe how true and faithful you fans are, and I thank you for hanging in here with us. We finally did it. God love you.
fans, and I'm proud for this city. You know, I think the 1990 Reds baseball season exemplifies what America is all about and what made this country great, that hard work and dedication and the will to win and pride in your work. And I think that was very evident on this ball club this year, and I'd like to just tip my hats to them all. They played their hearts out, and they're world champions. The only thing that really detracts from this, from our standpoint, is the fact that Eric is not here, and truthfully, if y'all can send him cards like it was mentioned before, it'd be great, because he was a big part of this. Thank you very much.
You want to meet the guys, right? Are we ready? All right, let's get things underway here, and as I look around, I'll bring them up. Danny Jackson, DJ, right here, and Jody and their kids. Danny, what do you think, pal? You went through one in Kansas City.
Yeah, we won it in Kansas City, but it wasn't as sweepy as it was here. It was great to, you know, to go out there and wipe them out. We really taught them what the National League and baseball is really played like.
All right.
They didn't know the word of baseball until they came to Cincinnati and saw us whip up on them. I'd like to thank all you fans for all your support. Did an outstanding job. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dan. Paul O'Neill, the Columbus Clipper, and little Andrew.
Thank you very much. It's, I don't know, growing up close to here in the 70s, I heard about this, but I never envisioned it'd be like this. And Oakland could talk all their crap, but we'll be wearing those rings. Thank you very much.
Oh, my God. Billy Hatcher. Yes, sir. Hit 798-421. Right here, Billy Hatcher. The Hat family.
World champion. Tell you, we just brought the world championship back to where it's supposed to be, right here in Cincinnati.
All right, Bill. Tony Perez, he remembers a couple of nice days on this mountain.
Big doggy.
Thank you. Now, we were number one in the 1970s, and we want to be number one in the 90s for a long time.
All right,
thank
Tony.
You.
The Nasty Boys, what do you say? Rob Dibble, yes, sir. Rob and his wife.
Are you guys happy now? I thought you were. You guys are the greatest. That's why we won this thing. It's because we got great support. You people believed in us when nobody else in America did. We went out there, we kicked their ass.
Rob Dibble never won.
And we are the world champions of the world. We are the best. We are number one. Thank you. I love you all.
Yeah. Rob. And next one, Norm Charlton.
The personality of a reliever. Intimidating. When he takes the mic, he means it. Yeah. There's Norm Charlton.
That is all the best, and we're the best. We got this thing here. Let's see if we can keep it for a long time.
All right, Norm, and Mr. Myers. Mr. Mello, Mr. Myers.
Well, really, it's Mr. Mello. But I think this town, hey, we brought it to you guys. We wish Eric Davis the best. And the fans, Cincinnati, you're number one.
All right. We got everyone. Jeffrey.
Great fans. We got a great fans in Cincinnati. The team did it. These are a great bunch of guys, and we're all number one. Thank you.
Scott Scudder, the Texas Tornado, yes, sir.
all winter.
All right, Scott. There's a guy that was a Yankee once, and I know he's happy to be a Red now, Hal Morris.
Thanks a lot for your support. You know, I'm happy we could bring the championship back to the Midwest, specifically Cincinnati. And this never would have happened in New York. And I'm just thankful that you brought me over here and let me play here.
All right, Hal. I want to tell you, this guy did a hell of a job this season. And as you all know, there had to be some decisions made. Tim Liana was not eligible for the World Series or the playoffs, but he was there rooting like all get out for his teammates. Tim Liana, hats off to you, buddy.
Gotta say that 1990 is the year of the Reds, and we showed them who is on top of the world this year.
All right, Tim. Who else we got?
You want to get it?
How about the GM put this show together, Bob Quinn?
Thank you, folks. This one's for you.
All right. Who else we got back in there?
We got everybody over here.
Terry Lee. Where's Terry Lee? Here he is. Right here.
Thank you very much. We'll come back next year and try to make it two in a row.
All right. Stan Williams, the pitching coach of the Reds. Big Stan's got a plane to catch.
Well, so far, you can, the fellas that are talking, you can see are more apt at playing baseball, perhaps, than public speaking. But forget the eloquence. Their motion is there. They are a happy bunch.
I don't think that you could say that Rob Dibble was not a good public spokesman. I think he echoed the sentiments of a lot of people right here in the city. And quite succinctly, too. Yes, he did.
You see the force of his personality when he's pitching. I mean, he just grabbed that mic and he took over. He is a leader. He's a nasty boy.
In the playoffs, I think you see there is a lot of pent-up emotion, a lot of criticism this season, and a lot of the criticism that I was talking about earlier on. The questions about the team's heart and so forth. Thanks, Cleveland. And that was that vindication we were talking about earlier, Jerry.
Republic. And we have a couple of Dominican dandies here. First, Mariano Duncan.
All right.
Thank you very much. I think that we showed to a lot of people around. Cincinnati Reds is the number one, the best team in baseball.
All right, and the next gentleman. His father-in-law was known as the Dominican Dandy. He is now the Dominican Dandy, Jose Rio.
I just want to say two things. We miss Terry Davis. And it's over. It's over now. I love y'all.
Next, from the Milwaukee Brewers, and now a world champion, Glenn Braggs.
Hey, no one said we can do it. We believed in ourselves, and you stayed behind us, and we brought this home to you. We're number one.
Next. From just down the river, up the river, New Richmond, Ohio, however it is, Todd Benzinger.
I don't know what to say, but whatever Dibble said goes for me, too. Thanks a lot.
And another one from down in the islands, Luis Quiñones.
Have you seen her?
Well, guys, I think we're very proud of us, and I think you have to be proud of ourselves, and we love you, and we're number one in the world. Champion!
Here's a guy that's pitched a long time in the major leagues, his first experience on a world championship team, Rick Mailer.
It's a long way from Atlanta.
It's great to be a Red. Thank you.
There's the Hammer. I call him the Hammer. You know that pinch hit single he got over at Riverfront here the other night? You remember it. You know what I'm talking about. They blamed it on the AstroTurf. Who gives a damn whether it was AstroTurf? It was a base hit. Billy Bates.
Thank you, Cincinnati. Y'all are number one, right along with the world champs.
I want to ask you all one question. How many of you thought Herm was going to bunt after two strikes? Raise your hand. You're all liars. Herm Winningham.
Thank you for the great time in Cincinnati. We're number one, and we're going to do it again next year.
Here's a guy that personally I'm as happy for as anyone, because we all know the tragic accident he had at second base a couple of years ago. He came back, he's on a world championship team, had some things to do with it. Ron Oster.
Wire to wire, and we end it with a sweep. We're world champions!
Got a lot of action at third base this year, waving him around. Tim Perlazzo.
You think we're good? We look good now? You haven't seen anything yet.
And also, Stan Williams' right-hand man in the bullpen, Larry Rothschild.
We might be the number one team, but you're the number one fan. Give yourself some applause.
Guy drove in the big run in the second game, and you all remember that friendly little ground ball just on the line, right? Joe Oliver.
Thanks for your support all year long. This championship's for you and for ourselves, and y'all are the best.
And the Mueller Flash, the University of Michigan Flash, and now the best shortstop in baseball, Barry Larkin.
I'm here with the rest of my crew.
I remember being out here in 1975 and 1976. We won it then. We're going to bring it back again next year. Yeah.
And the guy, his youngest son, is 1-0 in his very short life. Tucker Thomas is one win and no losses. And Tanner is way ahead of him. Tom Browning, and he's got Tanner with him. Tanner might say a few words, so just be ready.
Hey, it was a great year. You guys were fabulous, and today made it even more special. And we went out there and kicked some ass, and we brought it back to you. So let's do it again next year.
Now, you know why? You know who's next, don't you? Who?
Well,
being still in Oakland, and hopefully he's listening. Let's give a big cheer for Eric. What do you say? This is Fury ED for the Wreck. The best one. All right. We got another one. We have another one we want you to say hello to. I don't know. I don't think Billy was able to come, but a guy that did some things when we got him from the Houston Astros. He's out home in, where's he out? He's out there, White Oak somewhere. He's out there laying down. He said, look at those crazy fools down there in the rain. But he did a job for us. Billy Dorn, give him a big hand. The medical team that, of course, kept this ball club in good health this year. We'd like to introduce you to Larry Starr, the head trainer, and, of course, Dr. Lahan. And is Danny here? Is Danny right here? Larry's assistant?
Let me say a couple of things on behalf of Eric. Mike Lahan and I stopped by and saw Eric yesterday morning before we left Oakland. And he's doing pretty good. Obviously, he's in a little bit of pain and a little bit of discomfort. But he wanted to send his best to all the players and especially the fans, because he knows that you've been real supportive to him, and he knows that you'll send his best wishes to him. Thanks a lot.
Also, the guy that packs the bags, puts them on airplanes, buses, trucks, boats, you name it, Bernie Stowe and his troops. Where's he at? Here he is right here.
Oh, Lord, there. I hope we do in the 90s like we did in the 70s, and I hope we bring home about 6 World Series in them years. Thank you.
Well, folks, that takes care of my part of this program, and once again, we are number one, right? Yes. Turn it back to Marty. Hey, whoa, time out. One other guy. Kenny Griffey, we forgot all about Griffey. All right, now you can have it.
To wrap up the program today, I'd like to bring Marge Schott back with Shotzi. She's going to lead you in the singing of Take Me Out to the Ball Game. Marge?
I'll mention it.
This has been a wonderful day for all of my players and wonderful day for me. Thank you for doing it. Now let's go into that song that we love. Take me out to the ball game. Take me out with the crowd. Buy me some peanuts and Cracker Jacks. I don't care if I never get back, so it's root, root, root for the home team. If they don't win, it's a shame. So it's 1, 2, 3 strikes, you're out at the old ball game. God love you.
I don't want any of you to think that we forgot Jack Armstrong. We talked about Eric and being left behind because of the injury he suffered Saturday night. Jack Armstrong contracted a severe case of the flu, and he was unable to come back from Oakland with us yesterday. In honor of Jack Armstrong, who did a hell of a job for this ball club, you're not forgotten, Jack. We'd like to think that about the same time next year, we could all get together again for this very intimate little gathering and celebrate another World Championship. You truly are the greatest fans in baseball. We look forward to seeing you in 1991. Thank you very much.
Yes, we are definitely going to be back here next year, I think.
And to think that we're only 4 months away from having the pitchers report at spring training. World champion Cincinnati Reds. A great celebration here. Fans obviously supportive of all the players. A poignant moment when everyone started chanting, Eric, Eric, Eric. throughout the year, if we're honest, oftentimes when things didn't go well for Eric, the fans kind of turned on him from time to time. But I think by the end of the year, everybody got to appreciate what a great player he's been and an inspiration to this team. We all hope he gets better fast.
And we're going to be back with more from Fountain Square right after this.
Can't touch this. Can't touch this.
Did you know the Hamilton County Commissioners passed a gag rule to stop county workers from talking to news reporters? That's because they're afraid too much news would leak out about corruption and mismanagement in the courthouse. You see, the commissioners are embarrassed because they didn't want you to know when a county official lowered taxes for his friends. They're ashamed because you found out about a no-bid contract they gave their own friends that wasted your tax dollars. It's time to clean up the courthouse. John Merlesina for Commissioner.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Marion Spellman, and I'm visiting friends at Colonial Heights Retirement Community. They just love it here. There is so much to do. They've met so many new friends, been involved in interesting events and activities. Colonial Heights could be right for you. It was for my friends. A reasonable monthly fee covers all your amenities for independent living, from meals to maid service. There's an apartment size just right for your lifestyle. Discover Northern Kentucky's finest retirement community. There's no place like Colonial Heights.
Raised on his family's dairy farm in Crawford County, Paul Piper learned the values of hard work, common sense, and conservation. As a leader in our state senate, Paul Piper has shaped many of Ohio's important laws. He pushed through one of the toughest drunk driving laws in the country. As a prosecutor, Paul Piper fought to protect us from criminals. As an assistant attorney general, he represented Ohio citizens in courtrooms across the state. Paul Piper, independent leadership for a change. Paul Piper for attorney general.
The word is out. Fall clearance prices are in at City Mattress. Take $73 to $1,210 off 30 comfortable City Mattress sets. 10 to 30% off the nicest looking bedroom furniture you've ever seen. Your kids will love this stuff. You'll love the 30% off. 10 to 50% off beautiful brass beds, unique metal beds too. 10 to 50% off trundle beds, like this one. The word is out. Fall clearance prices are in at City Mattress.
Showing exactly what kind of feeling this whole city has for Eric Davis now.
This has been a moment we have waited for. We've said it so many times for 14 years. How many cities in America are lucky enough, one, to have professional sports franchises, and then to have such great success? We've had success over the years, with really since the 1960s, with success with the Reds in 1961, and then, of course, the great teams of the 70s, 70 and 72 against Oakland, and 75 and 76. And then with the Bengals, the great success they brought our community. So we are very fortunate not just to have a major league franchise, but to have one with the great kind of success that permits a Marge Schott, one of two women owners in professional baseball, to hold up a trophy above her head which says, "We are the champions of the world."
It is nice to see how the fans came out. Yes, it's raining. Yes, it's a miserable day. It's a bit chilly out here. The square was packed. Everywhere around the square was packed. The streets coming into Fountain Square was absolutely packed with people. Just to show the kind of thanks that we have for this team, what they've done for our city, and what they've done for us.
And thanks to some remarkable athletes, it's going to be a lot. Whoa! Sorry, Greg. Greg does sports better than he holds umbrellas. Okay.
in the news this afternoon. A Loveland man's on the operating table today to give himself, as well as others, a better chance at life.
You see, 40-year-old John Kerr is about 500 pounds overweight. He's having about 100 pounds surgically removed, and as News 5's Lisa Cooney reports, the skin will be donated to burn victims.
This is 40-year-old John Kerr. His appearance tells his story. But there's more to this man than the 780 pounds of weight that surround him. John is about to have an operation that will help him be able to do the very basic of things, like walk.
The whole stomach, it just limits everything I do. My walking and my sleeping, everything.
Over the years of dieting, John developed a large skin flap where his stomach is. The flap, called a panniculus, eventually dropped and fell away from his body. John hopes the surgery to remove the flap will give him a second chance at life.
More mobile, able to drive, just ride and everything. get up and do regular duty work,
Now, it's hard for you and I to imagine just what John has been living through, but Dr. Somersidi tells me this flap of skin that John will have removed weighs between 100 and 150 pounds.
To get the idea of what that is, a person of normal weight to take, say, a computer terminal and tie it to their body, and no matter what they do or where they go, sleep or awake, it has to stay with them, pulling on them all the time.
Doctors will use a laser similar to this one to remove the flap. The skin will be donated to help burn patients. It's the first time in Cincinnati history that skin tissue has been taken from a live donor.
And that's pretty unique, to donate this size of flesh for use by more unfortunate people than he is.
I hope it does what I want it to, so I can get out and do some things, instead of just sitting around all the time.
Be back to your old self, huh?
Right.
Lisa Cooney, News 5 Today.
And John Kerr's surgery began just a couple of hours ago. About the same time that the rally on Fountain Square got started, and as we can see, it's still going on, right, Norma? Jerry, Greg?
Yes, it is
still going on. There are people packing the square still. Celebration at the podium is over, but nobody wants to leave, even if it is raining. They still want to stay and celebrate a world champion team.
We're now getting into what we call the spontaneous celebration. This is an organized, this is just everybody screaming as loudly as they can. They're loving the red. People are starting to form around the streets of downtown now, partying, and I guess nobody's going back to work, nobody's going back to school. How many times do we get to be world champions?
Right.
What since 1976? The interesting thing to me is just to see the kids, the way they're taking to this thing, dancing out here on the sidewalks, moving around all over the place. I mean, the excitement, I haven't seen genuine excitement like this since the Super Bowl.
I'll tell you one thing I noticed, and you kind of noticed it with the players up there. Let's face it, most of these players are not from Cincinnati, Ohio. They're professional ball players. They happen to be contracted by a private firm here to play baseball. But as the season wore on, and as they started to get into the playoffs in the World Series, these guys now are feeling a real attachment to the community of Cincinnati. There's a transformation that we have seen just in covering them.
Yeah, I think you're right. I mean, people have brought their families up on the square up here, the babies, and everybody was excited about sharing it with their family. I saw Dibble raise his child over on his shoulders right after he made the announcement of what they kicked out in Oakland. But he raised him on the shoulder, and they're all very much family-oriented, and Cincinnati is a very family city. So it kind of rubs off once they got
it
here.
Does. Greg, you've been covering baseball longer than any of us have. The Reds, the second half of the season, let's be honest, they were playing 500 ball, maybe even a little below it. All of a sudden, they go in the playoffs in the World Series, and it's like no one in the world can beat them. What happened?
One of the old sayings in baseball is you don't win a pennant in April, you don't win it in May. But this team proved differently. That first half was so glorious that nobody could catch it. No one could catch them at all. And I don't think, really, when you stop and think about it, yes, against the Pirates, they did step it up a notch, and they played a notch higher. And in the World Series, still another notch. So the interesting thing about it is we haven't seen what this team can do yet. And I forget exactly who said that from the podium, but Sam Palazzo yeah. said, we haven't seen anything yet. Well, maybe not. Maybe this is going to be one of the great teams in history.
And well, they're certainly young enough.
Right, and we were talking earlier about how Eric Davis may not have been here physically, but he's been here in spirit. If you would like to write to Eric Davis, send him a goodwill notice or a card or something like that. This is the address. It's on your screen. I cannot see it. I'm sure at home you can see it.
It's Merritt. It's Merritt Hospital. What?
Webster.
Hawthorne and Webster Street. That's Merritt. Oakland, California, 94609.
So we're hearing it as you're hearing it.
Okay, that's Merritt Hospital on
Oakland, California.
In Oakland, California, Hawthorne Street.
Right, and Cindy McCarty's going to be there anywhere from 3 to 7 days with the kidney injury that he got in the last game of the World Series.
Okay, we're going to talk to some fans. We're going to try to step up here. Somebody step up here. Okay. We're going to try and talk to some fans.
You want to?
Yes, sir. What do you need?
What's your name?
Bob Draymond from Berlanger.
And who's the best team in baseball?
Oakland was.
All right. Okay, what's your name?
Greg Rampleman from Cincinnati.
Yes, well, we hope everything works out for you. Absolutely insane.
We always take those kinds of excuses ourselves, and we're just right in the middle of this right now.
Let's say, who's first? This is your first World Series. What's your name?
Kevin Gautrod.
Did you go to any of the games?
Oh, yeah. We went to the playoffs. Got the last one. We had tickets for the sixth game, but thank God.
Well, you could have been there. Are your kids old enough to get into it yet?
Yeah, they are. The other ones are in school. They couldn't come.
Do you remember the series of 75 and 76?
Sure.
Is this more exciting?
Yeah, a lot more exciting.
Great. Okay. Hey, look at the crowd here.
The crowd is absolutely crazy here. Dressed up for Halloween and dressed up for the Reds all at the same time. So what are we going to do next year?
The reason you have an interview is to try and find something out. But what in the world are we going to find out that you don't already know? These are Cincinnatians who have lived their whole lives waiting for world championships. They are absolutely ecstatic. Half of them ought to be someplace else, either in school or in work. How many, time out. How many of you should be in school right now? Well, there goes your tax dollars for education.
And they also like Jerry's commentary, so it can't be all bad.
Okay. I want to talk to this fella here. You.
Yeah, I've been coming to ball games for the last 25 years, and I think Cincinnati's got the best baseball team ever.
Okay. Is this team as good as the Big Red Machine of the 70s?
Yes.
Hell yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
The weather has not exactly been perfect. Well, okay, it's been really awful, but it doesn't matter. Nobody cares.
Microphone works or not. Okay.
Who's going?
Mike, you remember the 75-76 team. What's the difference?
Well, I was younger then, but they were expected to win, and after the 75 team beat the Red Sox, I think it was a foregone conclusion that we'd do well against the Yankees. Some of us thought so. I remember the mayor at that time in Cincinnati was rooting for the Yankees in 1976. Have you brought that up?
No,
I
haven't.
In 1976, he rooted against the Reds and rooted for the Yankees. And look what happened to him.
He has seen the errors of his ways.
I just wanted to bring that up, Jerry.
Good luck in your next job.
But seriously, it was exciting because they were underdogs. And anytime, it's an underdog situation.
Okay, what about the weather?
Okay, real quick, let me just show you a satellite picture. Right now, 52 degrees. It's been raining. We've had about a half. Game tonight. It's doing the same thing in Pittsburgh. Cleveland. It's going to be very muddy, so you may not be able to tell who's who without because they're going to have mud on their uniform. It's going to be drizzly, and it's going to be a damp day up there tonight, too.
And in Cleveland, they do have the mud.
Yeah, but this isn't Cleveland. This is Cincinnati.
Who said that? Okay. How long it's been since they had a champion, huh? Okay, we're going to take a break now, and then we'll be coming back to Fountain Square to watch thousands of crazy people crazy about the Reds.
Can't touch this. Can't touch this. My.
It's the Secretary of State's job to make sure elections are open and honest. That job is simply not being done. While most other state offices in the country have joined the computer age, for 8 years, Ohio's Secretary of State's office has failed to modernize its campaign contribution reports. Bob Taft will computerize campaign contributions because he knows that's the only way to keep track of special interest money and make the election process honest. Bob Taft, he'll make the election laws work for the people of Ohio.
How to bake a cake that's 94% fat-free without your family knowing the difference. Introducing Duncan Hines Delights. It serves up a cake 94% fat-free and still 100% delicious. Let it bake up, mouth-watering and moist. Don't give away the secret just yet. You'll know Delights is 94% fat-free, but all they'll know is it's 100% delicious.
How to bake your moist, delicious
bake. New Delights from Duncan Hines.
Hey, you made it.
How you doing, man?
All right.
Mom and Dad asleep?
Yeah, we weren't expecting you until noon.
Let's let them sleep for once. When did you learn to make coffee?
You have been gone for a while.
Nothing brightens your morning like mountain-grown Folgers. Mountain-grown coffee has more enticing aroma and richer flavor than any other kind.
You got a little thick around the neck, man.
Yeah, you old man.
Yeah, but you got it.
Guys, don't change.
You never did let us
The weather is brought to you by Mountain Grown Folgers Coffee, the best part of waking up.
You know, there was a couple of posters we saw in here as we came in. One person that was absent this year from the World Series was Pete Rose, and it was instrumental in putting the team together. For the years that he was manager, as a player manager, we saw a couple of, you know, free Pete Rose things. People were chanting free Pete Rose. And a lot of people have been talking about Pete Rose now that we've won the World Series.
Yeah, and I think a lot of it is because Pete Rose taught this team how to win. When he came back here in 1984, you all know it. This team was dead. They were flat. The only thing that was here was Dave Parker, and not that many fans were going out to the ballpark. He came back. He taught these young guys how to win. Unfortunately, he wasn't there to see the fruits of his work, and it's very sad.
Yeah. But he probably saw it now. He's feeling, this has got to give him some good feeling, because deep down he knows he's a part of this. And the players know that, too.
And
the players
know that, too.
And we haven't heard from him because he is definitely absent. The media not be a part of his experience of what he's going through. And I guess we can all understand that he wants to be more private into this situation right now.
Okay. Well, the inspiration comes not only from the fans for this great team and not only from the memories of years past, but also from some music which was put together. We played it all along this last month. Let's hear it one more time. You can't touch this.
You can't touch this. You can't touch this. You can't touch this. My music hit me so hard. Make me say, oh my Lord, thank you for blessing me. What am I doing? Fresh new kicks and pants, you got it like that. Now you know you wanna dance, so move out of your seat and get a fire girl and catch this beat while it's rolling. Hold on, pump a little bit and let the noise go on like that, pull a little bit, just fall on back, let them know that you're too much. And this is a beat they can't touch. Yo, I told you, you can't touch this. Why you standing there, man? You can't touch this. Break it down. Oh,
saver, though.
Hey, you never know who you're going to run into. I ran into the men in my wedding from Georgetown, Ohio, David Berry. I understand you had a rough time getting here.
Yeah, George, I got morning cows around. Had to run cows back in. Hurry up, get up here and watch us have a good time down here, George. Have a good time.
All right. Hey, you had time to make that necklace, Jill.
Oakland say bye-bye with.
Okay, thank you very much. As you can tell, it's still crazy down here. Back to the people where it might be a little calmer.
I don't think anything's any calmer. It is crazy. It is fun. We look forward to this for I don't know how many years, and I'm so glad it's here.
And the fans aren't leaving. I see a little kid over there. He says he's been here since 9 o'clock in this morning. Another fella comes in from New Jersey, Lou Piniella's hometown. Look, we might as well take it all in. This is like New Year, Times Square on New Year's Eve.
Exactly. The war is over.
It is over. We won Cincinnati, Ohio, the world champion. Not just the best in America, the best in the world. And we live here. This is our home, and we're number one.
It starts again in April, too.
In February, the pitcher's report. 4 months. Get down there.
Yeah.
Label.
Yeah, Jerry's getting a little ahead of himself here, but we got to savor this moment. Because this was the kind of team that at the beginning of the season they said, it's not going to last. It's not going to last. But it lasted. And it lasted wire to wire.
They have not spent a moment of this year out of first place. It's one thing to come from behind. It's even tougher to stay on top. They are on top. You're on top. This is our town. Congratulations, world champions. Back to the studio.
That's it.
Wonder Year.
Hello again, everyone. I've been covering sports here for a long time, and what happened last week in the World Series is unique in my experience. I've seen spectacular upsets before, but when a team sweeps another team in four games straight, that's not an upset.